Okay, some of you have already studied a little bit of probability, right? Agastya, at least you have studied it with me in the other class.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. I have.
Okay, some of you have it part of your school syllabus too, I guess. Is it there as part of grade 7 syllabus? At least yes. basic probability will be there, right?
Ma'am, I learned it in grade good. 7.
Okay, great. And how many of you know about set theory?
Ma'am, does this mean set?
Oh yeah, oh, yeah, that thing.
Ma'am, can you just recap, because I must have learned it, but I don't know what it is.
Okay, so today we'll stick to the overall story. I just want you to understand conceptually what is set theory, what is probability, you know, what kind of problems we can solve using these concepts, where is it used. So we will use technical terms definitely, but I will not get into definitions and stuff. There is no PowerPoint presentation today. We'll be just using the whiteboard, freeform learning. Just understand the concepts. Okay, so set theory is just a way to, again, I'm not giving you book definitions, just a way to, you know, I'm just describing it so that you understand what the real meaning is. So set theory is just to group things, you know, like group things based on a rule. For example, I say a set of students who chose basketball. Okay, ma'am.
It's basically dividing them into lists and different terms into separate lists. Like,
yeah, you can say classification. Yeah, putting them into groups or categories or classes.
Into different types of classification, like people who chose basketball as the subject and people who didn't.
Right.
And with this, we can also find common people in different types of classification areas and like people who are in none.
Exactly. Yes.
From the universal set.
Yes. So in each class, all the, you know, so in this case, we are talking about students. So, you know, each class has specific number of students. All the students follow this rule that they have chosen this basketball as a sport, or they have chosen cricket as their favorite sport, or the sport which they will play in school. But it can be anything. So I'll call the members of these sets as elements. So element could be a student. It could be something else. So each element in a classification group follows the same rule. That rule could be anything. So I just define a rule that maybe, okay, so let's say we define a rule for a set of numbers. And the rule being that the number should be, it should be a natural number, and it should be less than equal to 10, and it should be even. So which numbers will qualify this rule? So, you know, which numbers will be part of this set? I'll name this set as set A. So usually the names of sets are given by these capital letters. You could use other names too. This is just the common notation that we use.
So, ma'am, 2, 4, 6, 8, and 10.
Perfect. Yes. So all these numbers follow these rules. So this is a set named A. These are the members of the sets, which I called elements of the set. Okay. And this is the rule which each of these follow. So there is a specific form in which I can define a set in the any of these two ways. If I mention the rule, then I call it a rule builder form. I can just mention that this is the rule. All the elements that follow this rule will be part of the set. Or the other way is, which is also called roster form, where I exactly mention the elements, that these are the elements that are part of the set. So set builder form and the roster form. And set theory is extremely helpful in figuring out probabilities. Now, just one of you tell me what is the meaning of probability. You can be wrong. It's okay. Just come up with your own definition.
Probability is basically like how much something is probable to happen. Like,
right.
What are the chances that it would happen or occur?
Perfect. Right. So what are the chances that it will happen? For example, if I pick a coin, okay, and if I toss it, say...
There's a half chance it'll be heads, depending on the coin. If there's half a chance that it will be heads and half a chance it'll be tails.
Yes, that's right.
But there is slight chance that it would flip on its head.
Ma'am, like, we predict something.
That's right. Yes. Exactly. So, if I, you know, if my experiment is to toss a coin. And I do this, the number of trials that I do is, let's say I toss the coin 100 times. And I record the results. And out of these 100 times, say I got heads 498 times and I got tails how many times? 502, right? So then I could just say that, you know, in 100 trials, 498 out of, you know what, okay, out of 1,000 trials were heads. So this fraction is what represents the likelihood of getting a head when I toss a coin. So if it's a fair coin, let's say, so, you know, it may not always be perfect 500 and 500. So I can say the likelihood of getting a head, if I toss it 1,000 times, I got 498 times as head. You know, if you just repeat this again, maybe you get 499 head and 501 here. Maybe you get 497, maybe you get 503 here and 497 here. It could vary a bit, right? So then in this case, you can say that the probability of getting the fraction that represents getting head, the number of times you get head out of the number of times that, you know, the coin was tossed was this. And the probability of getting tails is 502 by 1,000. In terms of decimal, this will just become 0.498 and this will become 0.502. So very close, this is very close to 0.5. This is also close to 0.5. If you increase the number of trials, let's say now instead of 1,000 trials, if I just add a zero, if I am doing 10,000 trials, okay, this probability will get closer and closer to 0.5, and so will this get closer and closer to 0.5. So this is one way of finding out the probability of an event by just repeating that experiment, doing more and more trials and, you know, taking, observing what is the outcome, recording the results, and then coming up with fraction.
Ma'am, to like find out the probability of something occurring, you have to experiment with it. Like, what can happen a certain number of times, and with the data you collect of what happens each time, from there you can like find out the probability of like getting a flip, getting a head.
Right. But this is a long route, but you know, this is one way of doing it. So if you take this long route, you will figure out that if it was a fair coin, you get, the more trials you do, you will notice that, you know, their 0.5 is just like 1/2, right? So there are half of the times you will get head approximately, and half of the times you will get tails. So, but this is a time consuming process, which, you know, you may not have time to, you know, do so many trials of experiment or every time, you know, for everything that you wanted to find the probability of. So the shorter way of doing this is using set theory. So instead of repeating this experiment 10,000 times or 1,000 times, what we do is we just look at this experiment. Okay, the experiment was to toss a coin. What are the possible outcomes of this experiment? What are the possible outcomes? What can you get if you toss a coin? Unless
ma'am, heads and tails.
Heads and tails, right? Unless it is
if it is a flat coin.
If it is a Harvey Dent coin, then you have only one possibility. Heads, right? That is what.
Ma'am, but can't it flip on its side? There is a possibility.
That's a rare possibility, but yes, that.
Ma'am, but it can occur. Like, say, if you do it for 10,000 times, there is a chance it will occur.
Yes, that's a rare possibility.
But it's very minute.
It's really rare.
So like one upon 10,000 something.
Yeah, we'll have to experiment and see what, you know, how much it is. So if we just list down all the possible outcomes of this experiment. So this set contains all the possible outcomes of an experiment, and I call this set as sample space. Sample space of an experiment. And what this means is it is just a set, collection of all those things where each thing is a possible outcome of the experiment. So in this case, there are only two possible outcomes, head or tail. So if I have to now find the probability of one of these outcomes, then instead of taking this long route, all I can do is out of this sample space, just see how many of these outcomes are favorable to what I want. I am trying to find the probability of getting a head. I call this an event, the probability of an event happening, the probability of getting a head. So the only out of these possible outcomes, this is the only one that is favorable to my event, right? One favorable. So this probability can just be given by number of favorable outcomes divided by the number of total outcomes. So it's going to be 1/2. And this is with assumption that all these possible outcomes that I have listed here are all equally likely. There is no bias. I could have had a biased coin, which is a case we'll discuss later. But now I'm assuming that, you know, that my coin is perfect. So I had recently created a biased coin by using, what I did was I just used Fevikwik on one side of the coin. So it made one side of the coin surface uneven. And because of that, you know, whenever I toss the coin, it ends up like landing on the other side. You know, it rarely it lands on the uneven surface. It usually lands on the other side. So, you know, so my coin is more likely to.
But that will make it an unfair test because that coin can't represent the majority of the population.
Right. So that is something called as the biased coin. So we'll not discuss that case here. So, you know, what I'm teaching you here is for that case where all the outcomes are equally likely. So in a biased coin, all the cases will not be equally likely. You might get, you know, out of three tosses, you might get two times head and only one time tail. Maybe, you know, if I repeat the experiment 1,000 times, if my coin is not a fair coin, then it may be the case that I get head 700 times and I get tails only 300 times. So we'll discuss this case later on. For now, we'll just assume that all the cases are equally likely. Okay, so this is an easy way to find the probability where all that we do is we just first think of all the possible outcomes of the experiment. We put each outcome in a set. You can just draw a rectangle and put all the outcomes in the set. And then whatever probability you have to find, just look for how many outcomes, which of the outcomes are favorable to the event. And the probability of that event is just going to be the number of favorable outcomes divided by the number of the total number of outcomes. So basically, it's just a fraction. Okay. So what is the fraction that represents this? Let's take an example. So let's list down the possible outcomes. So our experiment is rolling a dice, and how many? So what are the possible outcomes? So there are different types of dice, right? You could have a four-sided dice, you could have a six-sided dice, you could have an eight-sided dice. Let's, for simplicity, just take our dice, which is four-sided. The one which you have in Ludo, no. The one which you have in Ludo is six-sided.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, let's take a six-sided dice. Okay. So what are the possible outcomes?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Right.
D6 has a 1 out of 6 chance of rolling a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Yes, right. So, because there are 6 possible outcomes, each of them are equally likely. So, getting any of these 6 outcomes, the probability of that happening is 1 by 6. That's correct. Let's find the probability that you get a even number as the outcome.
3 by 6.
It's 3 by 6, right? Because how many?
4 and 6.
Right. So the favorable outcomes are 2, 4, or 6. So if you get any of these three, that's in the favor of your event. So there are 3 out of 6 outcomes which are in your favor. So that's the probability. And this is nothing but 1 by 2, which I can also write as 0.5. So in any case, you will always get the probability somewhere between 0 and 1. Where 0 is the probability. What is the probability of getting a 7?
0, because it's not in the set, in the universal set.
Right. So favorable outcome 0, total number of outcomes 6. The probability of getting a 7 is 0. 0 divided by 6 is 0. That means it is something which will never happen. So that probability is going to be 0. What is the probability of getting a number between 1 and 6? Including 1 and 6.
Ma'am, I didn't get you.
What is the probability that you either get a 1 or a 2 or a 3 or a 4 or a 5 or a 6?
1 by 1. Like it's 6 by 6, but if you simplify it, it's 1 by 1.
Yes, right. So you like will always get one
of them. A perfect chance. 100% chance.
Right. So something which is guaranteed to happen will have probability 1. And something which will never happen will have a probability 0. In all other cases, it will be somewhere between 0 and 1. Yeah, Ved, you raised your hand. Did you wanted to ask something?
No. That was a mistake.
Okay. Okay, let's find the probability of getting, let's say you rolled 2 dice, okay? And let's simplify this a bit. Let's say you have 2 die with 4 sides, which are 4-sided. So your experiment is to roll both of these and find what is the probability of getting the sum of the two, the results of the two dice rolls, probability of getting a sum 5. So now you have to think deeper. What will be the possible outcomes? Now you are rolling 2 dice. Each of them are
2 dice, which 4 sides.
Yeah.
8 possible outcomes.
Okay, what will be the possible outcomes? Yes, tell me.
Ma'am, so you're looking for the sum, right? You're wanting to find the sum, or are you looking at the pairs of numbers?
Right, so I want to look at both the results. Like what was the result of the first dice? And what was the result of the second dice? So let's first think about the sample space. What are the possible outcomes? You can think it.
Ma'am, two.
Yeah.
Three, four, five, eight.
You can get also six. One, right? So, don't, no, I'm not asking in the form of sum. So, if you're rolling two dice, you can get a one on the first one, a one on the second one.
Yes, ma'am.
You can get a one on
ma'am, the there are one. 10 different combinations you can get.
There'll be more than 10. You can get a 1 on the first one and it could be 1, 2 or 3 or 4 on the second one.
Sorry ma'am, 16.
16, right? You could get a 2 on the first one and again 1, 2 or 3 or 4 on the second one. You could again get a 3 on the first one and get or and get 1, 2.
So you have to check for each term in the
Yeah, so first create the sample space with all these outcomes. So a better way of thinking about this is either through something called as probability tree, or in this case I would prefer using a table. So tree form is this, where you know, so let's write the outcome. These are the possible outcomes of the first dice roll, and for each of the outcomes what can you have in the second dice. So you could have these four possibilities in the second dice. So, you know, you can create, so these are called branches. This is overall a tree. And so for each outcome of the first dice, I can draw all the possible branches as to what can happen on the second dice. This is one way of doing it. The other way, which I would prefer in this case, is in the form of tables. So what you can do is just create these two XY axes. Just write down the outcomes of the first die here, the outcome of the second one here, and you can just complete this table.
Ma'am, can we draw a table, like a normal table?
Yeah, whatever way is convenient to you. It should just give you an idea of what are the possible outcomes. So this is one easy way. You can come up with some other strategy too.
This is like a grid.
Yeah, you grid. Can just create a grid, right? So maybe
like if you have ever played, what do you call it? Battleship.
Okay. Battleship.
Yeah. So, yeah. So
four and one, three comma and one, two and one.
And in our case, since we were asked to find the probability of getting the sum as 5. So, you know, instead of just writing 1 comma 1, let's write the sum. So if you get a 1 on the first dice, 1 on the second dice, the sum is going to be 2. If you get a 1 on the first dice, a 2 on the second dice, the sum is going to be 3.
Yes, ma'am.
Get 1 and 3. So let's just write the sums here. Then that will make it easy for us. This will be 3, this is 4, 5, 6, this is 4, 5, 6, 7, 5, 6, 7, 8. So now what is the problem?
And if that you the see it closely, there's a beautiful pattern.
Yeah, there is a pattern.
Yes. Like 2, 3, 4, 5, 3, 4, 5, 6, 4, 5, 6, 7. 5, 6, 7.
Exactly.
Eight.
There is a pattern. Yes. So,
five and
now tell me what will be the probability of getting the sum as 5.
Ma'am, there are 4 possible variations in which we'll get a 5.
Yes. Right? Now it's so easy to look at these options. Otherwise, you know, if you had to literally think as to what will be the options, yeah, you can think about it. And you will be able to think about it that if you get a 2 or a 3, 2 and a 3, or if you get a 3 or a 2, or if you get a 4, 1, 1, 4, these are the only ways you can get the sum as 5. So out of 16 possible outcomes, so now my sample space, the, you know, I can call it universal set or sample space, the set of all possible outcomes has 16 elements. Out of those 16, these four elements are favorable to my case. So 4 out of 16 is going to be the probability that I get the sum as 5. Now tell me, what is the probability that the sum of the two dice rolls, results of two dice rolls, is going to be greater than or equal to 5?
Greater than or equal to. Ma'am, it is, you can divide it into two parts.
Yeah, so the sum is, yeah, that's true. So the sum is, but this equal to is also there. So you have to include
it. It will also include the ones on the line. Mm-hmm. So it will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Right, so we have 10 favorable cases. Now this is favorable, this is favorable, this is favorable, this one, and this one. So 10 out of 16, that's going to be the probability of getting the sum greater than or equal to 5. Now tell me, what is the probability that I either get a sum greater than or equal to 5 or I get a sum less than 5?
Ma'am, I didn't get you. Can you repeat it?
What is the probability? The same experiment. We are rolling two dice, four-sided dice. Both dice have all options equally likely. So what is the probability that the sum of the results of the two dice rolls, the sum is either greater than or equal to 5 or less than 5?
Won't that be a 1?
Yes, that will be 1. Right.
But that encompasses all the possible values.
Exactly.
It can't be 1.
Why?
Because you can't get the number 1 while rolling two dice.
No, you don't get it. There's a 14 upon 14 chance. So if you simplify it, you'll get 1 upon 1, which is 1.
Yeah, but if... No, what I mean is, like, if you include numbers which are less than 5, then the number 1 is also less than 5, which cannot be rolled.
No, I think you got the question wrong. So, I said the sum being less than 5. So, the sum could be...
Oh, anything. Okay. Okay.
So, I'm saying the probability that the sum of the two results, the sum is either greater than or equal to 5 or less than 5. Got it? So, you know, it includes all the cases, right? If I'm saying the sum is either greater than or equal to 5 or less than 5, then all the outcomes satisfy that condition. If you pick any of these outcomes, you look at the sum, it will either be greater than or equal to 5 or be less than 5. Yes? Janvi, did you understand now?
There's a full chance that it will occur. So it is a 16 by 16 chance.
Yes.
When simplified, yes, will give you a 1 by 1.
It's a guaranteed event. It is bound to happen, right?
There is nothing else which is possible.
So Janvi, is this clear now? Do you have any questions? Okay. So that probability is going to be 1. So now this looks like a common sense thing, and it is a common sense thing, but now if I give it to you in the form of theorem, that is when students get confused. So that's why I wanted to discuss it this way before giving you those theorems and formulas. Okay, let's do one more question here before I give you that theorem. What is the probability that you will get the sum as even? Sum will be an even number.
Ma'am, 4 plus 4 plus 4, 4 plus 4, and 3 plus 3, 2 plus 4.
Okay. So you can just look at this table. Yes, Raman, you're thinking in the right direction. So
ma'am, that's
8, a long 8 by 16.
Route. Instead of that, you can just look for these.
There is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8. 7, and 8. So it's a half. The 50% probability.
That's it, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So yeah, so this is going to be 8 by 16. What is the probability that the either the sum is even or it's not even?
One.
Because, you know, that will include all the elements in the sample space.
Ma'am, but that is not always true. It depends on the elements in the sample. They are not necessarily rational numbers.
I didn't get your point, Sarim.
Ma'am, sorry, not rational numbers. They are not necessarily integers. They can be decimals and
fractions. Yeah, but in our case, we don't have decimals, right?
No, ma'am.
So, see, when I'm talking about this probability, you know, it is within the context of this experiment. What are the possible outcomes in this experiment? So, you know, my boundary is that sample space, that set of all possible outcomes of this experiment. I mean, you know, I am not generally talking about all the combination of numbers that will give a sum as even. I'm just talking about this set. That's my context. Okay, so in terms of theorem, what I can write here is, so in set theory, we have a word called complement, and what that means is what is not there.
This class is going very well today. Oh, you literally mean, do you literally mean to complement?
I mean the other complement. There are two complements, right? But thanks for the compliment, by the way. But I am talking about the other complement.
There's a complementary complement and there's a complement of a set.
Okay. So in set theory, so the spellings are also slightly different. There's an I, there is an E in one complement. There's an I in the other complement.
Complement is something which is not present in a set.
Exactly. So if I tell you there is a set of numbers, let's take a small one. Numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. So a set, this is a set which has these 7 elements, these 7 numbers. Each element is a number and these are the numbers. So now if I tell you that A is a small portion of this bigger set, I will call this as a universal set. Okay. This is... So, and A is a small portion of the universal set, a part of it, where A is a set of all numbers that are less than or equal to 3. Then which elements will be member of A? Which of these elements are going to be set members of the element A?
Can you repeat the condition?
Okay, so this is my universal set which has 8
all numbers,
3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yes. Now A is another set which is a part of the universal set, meaning it all the elements of set A are, you know,
in universal set.
From this universal set. So A is a set such that it has numbers less than equal to 3.
Less than or equal to 3. So
yeah,
that will be 3, 2, and 1.
Yeah, these three, right? So I can just
yes.
draw this oval. This oval represents set A now. So when I say A complement, which I either represent like this
or a dash,
it just
that means anything in the universal set which is not in A.
Yes, exactly. So what is not in A? So a universal set is our context. This is what we are talking about. Okay. So, you know, because otherwise, you know, if I tell you that A is a set of these three numbers, 1, 2, and 3. So what is this complement of A would mean whatever is not there in A, then, you know, there are so many numbers. There are infinite numbers which are not there in A. So A complement in that case will be an infinite set.
But you're taking it out of the universal set,
yes.
So it cannot be infinite.
Right. So we will stick to this context. So when we say what is not there in A, we only mean what is not there in A, but it is still there in the universal set. It is still part of our context. So A complement is going to be 8, 4, 5, 6, 7. These five are going to be the members of A complement. Okay. So in case of now, why we were discussing this was because I wanted to relate this to our probability example, where we discussed that the probability of getting the sum, we discussed that case where the probability of getting the sum as greater than equal to 5 or getting the sum as less than 5, that entire probability was 1, right? Because it covered the entire sample space. Our favorable outcomes were the entire set of outcomes. So in general, we can just say that if we talk about an event is just a part of sample space. So our sample space is the context. It is the universal set in terms of probability. And any event whose probability we want to find, we are just talking about in this context. So that event is going to be a portion of the sample space. So if you are trying to find the probability of any event plus the probability of that event not happening, that sum is always going to be
the universal set.
Yes, it's going to be 1. The probability is going to be 1. Yeah, the number of favorable outcomes is going to be universal set. Yes.
Okay, ma'am. So I like understood it wrong. I thought.
Yeah, I know you understood it.
Sum. The probability will always be 100 to pick something out of these two.
Yes. So in some cases, it's easier to find this. In other cases, it's easier to find this. So if you are asked, what is the probability of this happening? And maybe it's easier to find that. So you find that. Then you are asked, what is the probability of this not happening? So then you can just do 1 minus of probability of that happening. For example, if I ask you, if you roll a dice, 8-sided dice, what is the probability of getting a multiple of 3?
Ma'am, 6 and 3.
6 and 3 are the only two multiples. Yes. So there are 2 favorable outcomes. What are the total number of outcomes?
Ma'am, 8.
Correct. So that's the probability, which you can simplify it. It's 1/4. So now if I ask you, what is the probability that of not getting a multiple of 3?
3/4.
Perfect. Yes. So you can literally think about all those outcomes which are not a multiple of 3. That is one way. In that case, it will be 6 outcomes which are not multiple of 3, right? 1, 2, 4, 5, 7, and 8. These are not multiples of 3. So 6/8. Or you can use this, that, you know, because
ma'am, I think it will be easier if you put all the members in the universal set on the top right. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7,
yes.
8. Because you get to visualize it better.
Right. So whatever works better for you, you can write down all the possible outcomes. That's one way, yes. And then you can count. So in this case, the point that I wanted to make is the probability of something happening plus the probability of that something not happening is always equal to 1. So in this case, it was easier to find it either way. You could literally count. There were 6 favorable outcomes, which are not multiple of 3. So the probability is 6/8, which will also be equal to 3/4. Or you could use this option that, since you knew that the probability of getting a multiple of 3 is 1/4, so the probability of not getting a multiple of 3 is going to be 1 minus 1/4, because the sum of these is 1, meaning, you know, one of these is bound to happen. It's a guaranteed thing that it will be either this or this. So you can use any of these techniques. Okay, let's do one more question about cards. How many of you are familiar with the playing cards?
I am.
Ma'am, more or less.
Okay, so you have four kinds of symbols on cards, right? What are these symbols named as?
You have spades, you have hearts.
And?
Clovers and?
Clovers or club?
And diamonds. Clovers and clubs and diamonds.
Okay.
I'm not sure, ma'am, because that looks like a clover, so I'm...
Okay, I think it's called club. So these two are red in color and these two are drawn in black. Okay, and how many cards do we have in each category? Number of cards?
Ma'am, there are 52 cards, right?
Yes.
So there will be... 13?
Yes, so 13. Each of these symbols have 13 cards each. Total number of cards is 52. And in these 13, there is an A and there is then 2, 3, 4, up to 10. Then there is J, Q, K. These three are picture cards. There are big pictures drawn on these three cards. And a similar pattern in all these cards. So, okay, so now if you have a pack of cards, there are 52 cards, what is the probability that you will draw you pick a card at random, what is the probability that you will draw a picture card?
Picture card?
So the J, Queen, King, these cards are picture cards because they don't have numbers on the cards. There is a big picture on the card.
Ma'am, how many of them are in each?
Nine.
J, Q, K in each.
12 by 52.
12 upon 52, right? Because each symbol has J, Q, K. So there'll be 3 × 4, 12 picture cards in total. So the probability that the card drawn at random was a picture card is going to be this. Now, what is the probability? Now, if I ask you, what is the probability if you pick a card at random, what is the probability that it is not a picture card?
Not a picture card will be the... complement of the picture cards, which will be 40 upon 52.
Yes, it's just going to be 1 minus this. Or you can literally count that this A to 10, so 10 plus 10 plus 10 plus 10, so there are 40 favorable options out of 52. So you can count it directly or you can use this principle. In both cases, you get the same answer. What is the probability that you will pick a card which is red in color and a picture card? What is the probability of drawing a red picture card?
I'm 6. Upon 52?
It's upon 52. Yes, that's correct.
Because it will be hard of half of the total number of picture cards.
Exactly. Great. Okay, now, so you understand the basics of probability now. That's great. Okay, let's just do one last problem before we just close this class. Then we'll do some more probability in the next class and we'll also do statistics. This is the foundation of probability that we are doing now. Okay. What is the probability of drawing a red colored A?
Okay, well,
map 2 by 52.
Yes, everybody agrees with that?
Yeah, 1 over, yeah, 2 by 52.
Yes. Okay, what is the probability of not drawing a red A?
50 upon 52.
50 upon 52. See, so in this case, this counting is going to, this is still a possible route, but it's a long route. You will take longer time to calculate these set of possible outcomes. So, you know, in some cases, thinking in the other direction is easier and faster. Okay, good.